Welcome back to Razmafzar TV. Today I'm having Bede again from Australia, who is going to show us some laminated and lamellar armor he made. Hi Bede, welcome to Razmafzar TV channel.
Nice to see you. How are you?
Thank you very much. Very well, hope you too. Bede, yes. Could you please tell our viewers what you are going to show, what type of armors you made and you would like to share with us, please?
What I'm going to show is some pieces of armor. One is a laminated Jawshan with shoulder guards. Another piece is a small scale lamellar helmet avantail, not on the helmet because I wanted to be able to turn it inside out and show how it's laced up in that. And another piece is a neck guard. The lamellar equivalent of a gorget or gorget, which generally speaking, I think that in quite a few cases, things like the shoulder pieces would have been attached directly to this rather than attached to the main armor. I noticed that by the 15th, 16th century, these neck guards are actually laced into the top of the armor. You don't have any shoulder straps anymore. They're surviving Tibetan complete armors with this structure. And I really think it's probably an improvement. There is a development in the way lamellar armors are put together and laminated armors, which are their descendants. I mean, a laminated armor is really a state's response to having to make a lot of armor and to get as much of the benefit out of the flexibility of lamellar armor, but in a way where it can be mass produced. And laminated armor is really good for that. You could probably make 10 laminated armors in the same time as it took to make one lamellar armor. The advantage of a lamellar armor is that small villages and even nomads can put them together if they get access to the scales. And so, you know, like a barrel full of scales or something. I haven't tracked anything down talking about the prices of these things, but I'm guessing that you're looking at the price of a couple of horses or something. To a nomad, that would be acceptable. And then they would lace them together as they saw fit. A thing that's important is that when these armors started out, they were probably chest pieces and back pieces laced together up the sides with straps over the shoulders, because that's the easiest way to make a one-size-fits-all armor. And the armor I made two armors that way. Then we tried making the open up the back armor, which turns out to be a misinterpretation. A lot of further research, we realized that these armors that were being displayed in Chinese encyclopedias were not in fact back opening armors. They were front opening armors that were laid out with the back to the viewer. There's good reasons for this. When you actually make them, you realize these front opening armors are so much easier to put on. You can still get away with the one size fits all because you basically overlap the front more. It also gives you the ease of moving your arms across your chest because the two parts of the armor slide past each other and then slide back. So when your arms are crossed, you've actually got double armor down the front. So these things we learn. The next two armors I made after that were front opening armors. And I think a lot of people think that by having this solid, completely connected front side opening armor, you've got better front protection. But in reality, I don't think it's worth the difficulties of, if you can put on your armor by yourself quickly, that's a bigger advantage than the off chance of a 3% better protection because there are no overlaps or gaps. And a lot of people, when they talk about the effectiveness of armor, are looking at it from the point of view of close in dueling type fights. whereas the main use of armor was to protect large groups of professional soldiers rather than individual warriors who were going out to duel with each other. I mean, I'm not saying that didn't happen, and certainly in literature it's very popular. You often see these famous heroes challenge somebody, you know, like Rustam and Isfandiyar and people like this. But I think that's more literary than it is practical, because when you assemble armies of 30,000 men, you're not really going to stand around and wait for some guy out to have a little duel, which might prejudice your side if your guy loses, because you're looking at morale and things like that. But this is the reason that you see in Byzantine manuals, and even in things like the Secret History of the Mongols, they specifically say, don't let anyone go out and challenge somebody from the other side in front of the battle line. You got, in the Mongol army, you got executed for it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I think it was pretty close to that in the Byzantine army. The Byzantines had a kind of, they were very strict, but they didn't really like executions as a punishment, but they still would. So the thing is that these armors are not designed to be perfectly protective. They're not like European plate armor. European plate armor is the product of a particular type of warfare and a very metal rich culture. I mean, plate armor really came into its own after the Black Death, when the collapse in population in Europe meant there were more resources. It sounds weird, but that's apparently what happened. But in the Middle East and Central Asia, even as far over as China and Korea, things were different. The armies were much bigger. You had to equip them. If you wanted to have all your armored horsemen, you're not talking about, you know, 300 knights and 1,000 men at arms. You're talking about 10,000 armored horsemen or 20,000 armored horsemen. So the scale of production that had to be high. And in the 18th and 19th centuries, everybody brought along their own equipment. So to get into the army, you had to invest. And the investment was getting this equipment, but there had to be people making it. And of course, if you were lucky and you killed somebody important, you'd get better equipment by stealing it. See, the advantage of a lot of these armors is that they're not form fitted to a particular size. And from what I can tell, I mean, the place that we've got good records from, like Manchu China, things were usually in three sizes, and that'd basically fit everybody. So you'd go and you'd pick out an armor that fitted you, and off you went. The Ottomans had an arsenal system in a similar way. Whereas you could get beautifully tailored male shirts, a lot of people got a kazagand, which just looked like a jacket, and you cinched it up with a belt and maybe overlapped the front because it was front opening. And that gave you the facility. So if you're a small man and you put on an armor that's a little bit too big to you, you overlap it more at the front. You actually get a better armor. The people that were probably had the biggest problems were the very big people. But even so, I lent my full lamellar armor to an American friend who I think is 6'6". I'm 5'5". The armor fits me and it fitted him. It didn't go down to his knees as it does on me, but torso wise, he was perfectly well protected. And he used it for a year in America in SCA combat, which means it got hit a lot. When it came back, there wasn't any damage. And this is just leather lamellar. This is the neck guard I made for it. It's a bit dusty. As you can see, it's individual scales laced together. The whole neck, the inside of it, it's in two rows of scales.
Mm-hmm.
And the top row is covered in leather, so it doesn't rub against your throat. And I'll just undo its laces.
What kind of hide is that, Bede?
This is cowhide, 5 millimeter thick. It's been soaked and hardened. It's not boiled. I don't think that was very common. As you can see, it covers that part there. So anything coming in there, that hurts. it's really quite tough.
How did you harden it?
I did it by a process of soaking when I dyed it, instead of dyeing it by rubbing dye on, I soaked it in the dye. And the dye has a small amount of alcohol in it to activate it. It's mainly water and pigment, but there's alcohol in it as well. And we didn't know this was going to happen, but when it dried, it went really hard. And it's lacquered, it's pretty water resistant, so it doesn't go out of shape. However, I found that when you bake scales, that is basically cook a slightly damp scale in an oven at below the boiling point of water, so like about 98 degrees Celsius for about 20 minutes. I learned this online on YouTube, so it's out there. But the scale goes very hard. You dye it after you've done this. You punch all your holes, you cut it, you shape it, then you cook it.
Cook it like you put it basically in the oven, or you cook it in
water? Yeah, you put it in a tray, put it on a tray, put it in the oven with the oven turned right down. This is a kind of technique that anybody could have done. You don't need anything special. And your way of telling whether it's too hot is just to put a cup of water in there. If the water boils, it's too hot. So you wait till that stops happening, put it in for 20 minutes, and you can put hundreds in, right? If you had access to a baker's oven in a small village or something like that, you could turn up when all the bread was done and the oven was cooling down and whack in thousands of scales. What happens is that after this process, the scale goes very hard, even harder than these, and it's no longer susceptible to softening by water. So if you get it wet, you can't, it doesn't suddenly become bendable or moldable. It stays exactly the same. I found this out by mistake because I was experimenting with Assyrian style rectangular scales. Mm-hmm. And I got some that had dried the wrong shape, and I thought, I'll just, like ordinary leather, you just drop it in water and then it'll go soft and you can, it stayed exactly the shape it dried in. And I think this is the way to make strong leather helmets. I'm going to try. I've got to make a form so that you can lace the helmet together damp and then put the whole form in the oven so it dries, and then you take it out and dye it and everything and then relace it with permanent lacing, to see if we can get the level of hardness that people talk about. A lot of people have tried boiling it leather in wax, and as quite a few people on the internet have pointed out, wax is a wonderful lubricant and it's very good for helping you cut through things. It's extremely dangerous to do, and the side effect is that you make something that's very weak against sharp edges. It's quite good against blunt force, but against sharp edges, not good, and terrible in hot climates because the wax starts coming out of the leather.
Oh.
So my guess is that when people started off, they were wet molding the leather, and I don't know whether they wet molded it and dyed it or whatever, but something in the process started hardening the leather and they worked out how to do it. And then this baking process, I mean, in French, they call hardened leather cuibouille, which means technically boiled leather. Yes. But I'm wondering whether it actually means cooked leather, because I had some friends who made the boiled leather style of cuibouille, and it was very much a dip the scale in the boiling water really fast and get it out. There was a a 3 second window, and if you left it in too long, it'd go brittle like a biscuit, and if you took it out too quick, it wouldn't harden at all. As a technical process, it's not a very good one. It's not adapted to mass production, and all lamellar and scale armors and brigandines are designed for mass production. They didn't appear until big armies needed lots of armor. And this is what I when I was doing research back 30 years ago, one of the things that came up was there were armors found in Inner Mongolia that were from a hand fort, and they found them in the ditch outside. You know, the fort had a dry moat around it, and there was pieces of armor and whole chest pieces and everything in this ditch. They were part lamellar. The shoulders and the skirts were lamellar. The body was long splints laced together in a stronger, less flexible manner. And the thing was, they were essentially spring steel.
Spring steel?
They were, after 2,100 years in the ground, they were still springy. About a millimeter thick. With the overlaps, you're getting something, an average thickness of about 1.5 to 1.8 millimeters. But because they're flexible and they bend under stress, they distribute the force better. Mm. So that, and these were, I mean, Han armies were big. The kind of armies they sent to fight the Xiongnu were often over 100,000 strong. Now, not everybody's going to be wearing armor or anything like that, but the production levels were very high. When you look at Sasanian Iran and you look at the Gurgan Wall and the big fortresses along there and the huge storehouses and armories, then these empires were, you know, they were mass producing weapons for big armies. It's yes. Not, you know, it's not the village blacksmith stuff.
No.
So anyway, but the thing about this is the perfect example, because I've got to redo some of the lacings on this. The perfect example of if you are trying to rebuild lamellar scales or lamellar armor or a laminated armor, any kind of armor that has holes and lacing in it, and you put it together and you've got leftover holes, you're not doing it right. Because nobody punches holes unless they're going to use them. That doesn't mean there aren't armors laced up where all the holes aren't used, because what happens is metal scales survive longer than the whole armor. So you might, in Tibet, they go into monasteries and find whole armors with all the lacing intact, but there must be lots of places where the lacing deteriorates, animals eat it, rats particularly like eating leather lacing. So you end up with a bucket load of scales. And what do you do if you want to make another armor? If you know how it was laced together, you lace it together the same way. But if you don't, you lace it together as close as your style of armor is laced. And that's pragmatic. I mean, you know, I've seen a hand armor that was laced together in a way that to me looks so crazy, because there were so many zigzaggy bits and it had to be put together in a whole piece. You couldn't make it in pieces and put them together. And I thought, that can't be right. But the archaeologist involved told me, no, that's how it came out of the ground. And to me, that says somebody's got a whole bunch of these things and invented a new way of lacing them together, because, hey, they didn't know how it was originally intended to work. And I think this kind of thing happens over and over. So when you see an armor in one particular arrangement, that doesn't mean that was the generic arrangement for it. That might be somebody's solution to a problem of, I've got scales, I need an armor, I don't know how to make the armor these scales were cut out for, but we'll do it. One of the things that surprised me, because my approach to this is a manufacturing approach, not a craftsman approach. To me, the logical thing to do would be to make all your scales the same. If you've got different sizes for different parts of the body, do that. And then lace them up. And then you end up with what we have here on this Aventail, you end up at the end of the row. Oops, I'm going to get this in. At the end of the row, you've got lacing holes for another scale, but you're not going to do that because that would be crazy. So you've got to stop somewhere. But in real armors, certainly the ones in Tibet, those end row scales don't have those extra set of holes because those scales were made specifically to run down the ends of the rows. And that gave, I mean, it saved punching maybe 100 holes, which doesn't sound much, but obviously they thought it was worthwhile. Perhaps it actually made a better armor. I don't know. But the thing about lamellar that I found quite interesting is by careful placing of the vertical lacing, this in this case it's black, you get complete collapsibility. So that if this is on your chest and you bend forward or something like that, that just completely collapses and you've got total flexibility. But there's never a point where it stretches out so far that anything is exposed. You can't get anything in there. And if you try and stab, I've got a letter opener here. This is not a good example. But if you try and stab through and get under, you get it into the middle ones, it's really difficult. You can, but it's really difficult. So that in an ordinary battle situation, you're pretty safe. If you're in a hand-to-hand kanja to kanja fight, yeah, you can get in. Because these armors are made to a standard for battle rather than a standard for dueling. And you don't, I mean, you see in some of the Jalayirid paintings, from the like early Timurid, late, you know, just post Ilkhanid period, you see sometimes like there's a famous painting of Isfandiyar and the dragon where he's got wonderful bazooband and complete armored gauntlets and armored legs and, you know, and under his leopard skin jacket, he's probably got mail and everything like that. But the average person probably who could afford armor probably didn't go that far. It's really interesting if you look at the Ilkhanid paintings of armored horsemen, which almost all the horsemen in battle are wearing armor.
Yeah.
They don't have any bazoobands. The Mongols, for some reason, the Persians had them. If you look at the 8th century, like the from Mount Mug in Sogdia,
yeah,
bazoobands. Lamellar or laminated armor, but bazoobands, they were there. So it's just that different styles of fighting. Maybe you had bazoobands if you were going into a lot of close fighting. Yeah. Maybe that's particularly Iranian heavy cavalry like this. There's a, I mean, you know, it's, I think that might be true. But you can't say everybody went for full-on protection. I see a lot of people, because it's in the sources, saying, oh, well, you've got your mail shirt on, you put your lamellar jawshan over it and all this kind of stuff. But in reality, if you wore a jawshan and a thickly padded coat under it, that'd probably be enough protection for most people.
It will. I agree.
So, I mean, here I'm going to get, I'm going to put some shoulders on, which, it's always fun. I'm actually upgrading these.
Wow.
Because I've made some, This is why people wore little caps and everything, so the hair wouldn't get messed up. But I just have to reach behind. Oh, that's the other problem with straps, is they get caught up in things. The idea being, of course, you can put this on without too much trouble. I'm trying to find the other strap. I know it's down there. It's when in doubt, turn it round and